Okay. Or his value. Okay, so the algorithm is very simple. Maurice Herlihy became extremely famous, became very famous, with four-line algorithm. Four lines. This is the algorithm. So the algorithm does the following. Everyone, we have two processes. Everyone wants to propose a value. Okay? So Petr and I want to go to the movies. I propose James Bond. He proposes Asterix. Okay? And we want to decide, but we don't want to fight. We just want the algorithm to decide for us. What does the algorithm do? Each of us writes his movie to his register. I have a register, he has a register. So I write James Bond in register R0, I'm P0. He does that for register R1. Okay? And then we have a counter, the fetch and increment counter. We have it here, we assume we have it. The counter is initialized to 0. Our algorithms go to the counter, fetch and increment. One of us will get value 1, the other one will get value 2, right? This is what you expect from the counter. The algorithm is such that the one who gets value 1 decides his own movie. If I get value 1, I decide James Bond. The one who gets value 2 decides the other register. That's the algorithm. Okay? This algorithm will guarantee that either we go to James Bond together or to Asterix together. Is it clear? How do we decide? The fetch and increment decides. Is it clear? Notice that I'm not implementing fetch and increment. I assume it. I'm simply saying, if I have fetch and increment, I can build consensus among two. Clear? Clear? If you have a counter, you can agree for two processes. Any problem with that? Clear? So this is an algorithm that brought, that has a fundamental result, that allowed a fundamental result. Why? Because the world of fetch and increment, and you can do the same exercise with other objects. You can use them to solve consensus. This is a practical world. Fetch and increment, queues, etc. These are all objects that people were really caring about in practice. And there were these theoreticians working about this object called consensus. And this algorithm brings the two together. This is very fundamental. Why? Because once you bring the two together, you can reuse all the theoretical results about consensus. And the famous theoretical results about consensus is the following. The result was initially stated in 85, and what I'm going to present here is a different variant of it, adapted to shared memory. The result says there is no asynchronous. Asynchronous, remember I said, we don't know nothing about the relative speed of processes. Deterministic. All what I've said is about deterministic. If you start allowing randomization, the game changes. There is no asynchronous algorithm that implements consensus among two processes using only registers. Okay? So this result was not proved by Maurice Herlihy. This is Fisher Lynch Patterson, this is Louis and Abu Amar. This result talks about consensus, but this algorithm enables me to say, therefore, fetch and increment is impossible with registers. Clear? Okay? Good. Now, I'm going to prove this. Very simple. The proof has been published in 85 and then rephrased in 87. Very simple. Have you heard about FLP? Have you heard? Okay. This is a fundamental result. Why? Because it tells you that something that looks simple, two processes they want to go to the movies together. Looks simple. Impossible. Impossible with registers. Again. But again, if you think about it, why should that be hard? Two processes want to agree on the same thing. They can communicate with registers. Why should it be hard? Intuitively, it is hard because we want the agreement to be deterministic. We want them to always agree, first. Second, we are saying the following. The two guys want to go together, but we want the algorithm to be weight-free. Algorithm weight-free means no matter what happens to Petr, I want to go to the movies. Petr dies, but he's not here, I still want to go to the movies. Okay? So this is weight freedom. The combination of this is deterministic, I want to make sure we go to go. Second, I don't care what happens to him, I want to go to the movies. Third, we have only registers we can read and writing, makes the situation difficult. Of course, if we had time, I would have asked you, using a different route, to think about a consensus algorithm with registers. And I do this every year with my students in Lausanne, and they have fun because they believe it's easy. And they start writing algorithms and they argue, no, this works, of course it works, what is wrong, blah, 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 blah. And it's not always easy to see why it doesn't work, but it takes time. Okay. I will come back to this. Yes, please. No. It's none of them. Weight freedom is simply something I'm assuming. I said I'm not going to repeat it. When I say implementation here, I mean weight free. Yeah, it's me who said everything is weight free in this talk. In the original paper, the way it was described is the following, is to say, I have a set of processes, they can fail. Each of them should be able to return from propose no matter what happens to the others. So they didn't say weight free, but they said each of them. This is weight free. Okay, so now we are going to prove. Who has ever seen this proof? Some people have. Sorry about repeating it, but maybe now you will digest it completely. Okay, so there is no algorithm that implements consensus among two processes using only registers. This is what we're going to prove. Weight-free implement. The proof is also very simple. Again, 85, it looks weird. Something as simple as that, impossible? Come on, this is not the halting problem. It could not be impossible. So it was very surprising. Now it looks very easy. We understand very well why. You will see. So we prove it by contradiction, as many things in concurrent and distributed computing. We assume you have two processes, P0 and P1, and they can use as many registers as they want. While proving this, I hope I will give you some tools to be able to prove other results. It's the same game. This is an impossibility proof, and all of them look pretty much the same, pretty much the same. So we assume there is an algorithm that exists, and this algorithm works for two processes that we call P0 and P1. And we are going to show that this algorithm will have a flow, and we will see what the flow means. And the game of the flow, you will see how it works. And this is a general game. Okay, I need some elements, some terminology, because I'm proving something is impossible. I need to show that this algorithm will not work. So no algorithm will work. So I need some exhaustiveness. So the concept that is important is the notion of a global state of a distributed system or a concurrent system. It's called a configuration. What is a configuration? Is, think of it as the set of values in the registers. I assume that we have only registers. Assume you have only registers. A configuration is the set of values of the register. Of course, the algorithm consists in changing configurations. At any point in time, somebody external, God, looks. This is configuration number one, configuration number two, configuration number three. Okay? So far, so good. So this concept is important. How do we go from one configuration to the other? By having processes write in registers. Right? This is called the step. More specifically, a step of the computation is writing in registers or reading. Writing is what changes configurations. Reading does not. But the two kinds of steps we have is read and write. Okay? Good. So I'm going towards some game definition. Now, we have a particular way of talking about this game. We want to show that there is a situation where this algorithm that I'm assuming will have a flaw. Okay? So now I'm assuming what we call an adversary. An adversary is an abstract entity. Think of it as Satan or whatever, whose purpose is to defeat your algorithm. It's called an adversary. What does the adversary decide? The adversary decides something very important. It tells you who is the process who is going to execute the next step. I devise an algorithm. I say, if P0 executes the next step, he does this. If P1 executes the next step, he does that. But I don't control who executes the next step, right? I don't, as a deviser of the algorithm. Why? Because I'm assuming there is no relative speed constraint on the processes. Are we together? They can take a nap, P0 can execute, P1 can execute, etc. Right? This means that there is a different entity called the adversary, which decides that. Now think about it as a game. Okay? So, it's like saying, there are rules of the game, this is the algorithm, but who plays next is decided by a different entity. So in the chess, we know, P0 executes, P1 executes, P0 executes, P1 executes, that's the rule. No, this is a different game. Who plays next is decided by somebody else called the adversary. Can you hear me in the back, Ashur? Okay. So you cannot hear me, or it's for the recording, yeah. Okay. So the game in distributed computing is to build rules, the algorithm, such that no matter for a given adversary, the rules are good enough for your algorithm to work. Here, we are assuming the adversary is very powerful. It's very powerful because he decides who goes next. He can decide that P0 goes for 100 steps and then P1. You see what I'm saying? I'm simply rephrasing what I told you before in slightly more precise terms. Okay? Yes. Any question here? This is important. I have always been assuming I do the algorithm, and there is this adversary who says, oh, P0 grabs the lock, keeps the lock, now P1 comes, now P0 comes. I'm assuming some bad guy is there trying to defeat the algorithm. Now I'm trying to prove that something is impossible. I am the bad guy. I am the adversary because I want to find the strategy to defeat the algorithm. Okay? So the game is the following. When I want to prove something impossible, I'm this guy. I want to find the algorithm of the adversary. Okay, good. So, the adversary decides which process executes the next step. And the algorithm decides the next configuration. I'm just rephrasing the game we have been playing from the beginning. Okay? Any question? Good. Okay. I told you, the adversary decides who goes next, how many steps it executes. This is called a schedule. Schedule is what is a history of an execution. You look at which process executes which step, how many times, etc. This is called the schedule. The adversary decides the schedule. And when we say that a system is asynchronous, we are saying all schedules are possible. This is asynchrony. Asynchrony means all interleaving are impossible, are possible. So the adversary is powerful. A weak adversary cannot do much. A strong adversary can choose whatever it wants. So it's like saying, I am the adversary and I'm controlling who speaks. I say, you speak. Then he speaks. Then he speaks. And you speak again. And then you speak again. And then you speak again. I decide that. And you have to come up with some algorithm to do something, even if I can decide who speaks for how long. Okay? I'm a powerful adversary. It makes it hard for you. Okay? So, what the algorithm A which we assumed must ensure. It ensures what we call agreement. We go to the same movie. And validity, we go to a movie that one of us have proposed. One of us has proposed. And of course, each one of us who remains alive has to go to the movies. Okay, now, we have two notions that I talked about, three, configuration, step, schedule. Configuration is a set of states. This is just a summary. A step is an elementary action executed by some process. Read or write. That's the only thing they can do. Okay? Schedule is the interleaving of process names. You speak, you speak, you speak, you speak, he speaks, she speaks, etc. Are we together? These are the ingredients of the proof. They basically define the model. Are we together? Okay, now we can jump. Once you have these things in mind, the proof is actually very easy. Given U a value to be 0 or 1, we say that a configuration C is U valent. So configuration is a set of states. We say that a configuration is U valent. Remember that U is 0 or 1. If starting from C, from this configuration, no matter how the processes behave, meaning no matter what the schedule is, no decision other than U is possible. Okay? This is a definition of, so we have a set of configurations. Once we plug them onto an algorithm, we define the notion of zero valent or U one valent. We say that a configuration is one valent if, no matter what happens, at once you reach C, the decision one, it's as if it was already decided. Even if the processes don't know it yet, the algorithm will decide one, okay? And vice versa. So here, I'm assuming to simplify that the goal of the consensus is zero or one. James Bond is zero, Asterix is one. We just need to decide zero or one, okay, to make it simple. We say that the configuration is univalent if it's either zero or one, otherwise bivalent. A configuration is bivalent, that's important, this means when we reach it, we still don't know whether it's going to be zero or one. The decision depends on the schedule. Okay? Zero valent, the decision does not depend on the schedule. One valent does not depend. Bivalent depends on the schedule. With a bivalent configuration, the adversary is in control. Zero valent, one valent, the adversary has already lost. Okay, so this is the... Okay. Now the proof. The proof stands on two lemmas. The first says there is at least one initial bivalent configuration. You take any algorithm you want, the adversary can put the algorithm in a situation where it starts from a bivalent configuration. Okay? I told you something. I said the adversary decides the schedule, but the adversary decides something else, which I forgot to say. The adversary decides which values we are proposing because we want the algorithm to work for all values we could propose. Okay? So the adversary also decides that. So the adversary can decide the initial configuration such that it is bivalent. First lemma. Second lemma says the following. Given any bivalent configuration, there is an arbitrarily long schedule S of C, I will explain what this is, that leads to another bivalent configuration. So let me rephrase. This says the adversary can launch the algorithm, start the algorithm from a situation where both values are possible. Second lemma says the adversary can keep the processes going from one bivalent to another bivalent forever for an arbitrarily long schedule. This means the adversary can arrange the scheduling such that we never decide. Okay, we're going to go and dive into each of them. First one, there is at least one bivalent configuration. So assume we have two processes. They simply want to decide 0-1. Can you give me an initial bivalent configuration? Remember, a bivalent initial configuration is one such that
starting from that configuration, the processes could either decide 0 or decide 1. Can you give me an initial bivalent configuration? What would that be? Exactly. The adversary simply tells Peter, you propose 0. And he tells me you propose 1. Because if we both propose 0, there is no choice. We're going to decide 0. If we both propose 1, we are going to decide 1. If he proposes 0 and I propose 1, it's not clear what the decision is going to be. For example, if he crashes immediately, I'm going to decide 1, of course. If I crash immediately, he's going to decide 0. This is a bivalent configuration. Okay? Lemma 1 is trivial. You agree? Very simple. Any question? Good. All these things are simple once you take the time to read them carefully. First lemma is very simple. Now let's go to the second lemma. Notice one thing. This lemma doesn't say anything about whether we are using registers or not. This lemma is general. If we start from different values, both decisions are possible. Okay? Now, here, the lemma says, given any bivalent configuration C, there is an arbitrarily long schedule S of C. Okay. That leads to another bivalent configuration. In fact, problem is that if I leave it, is it okay now? Okay. This S of C should be here, I'm sorry. There is an arbitrarily long schedule that leads to another bivalent configuration, S of C. Okay. This is wrong, what's written here. I apologize. Okay. Here's what you should do to make it correct. There is an arbitrarily long schedule, S. S is the name of the schedule. That leads to another bivalent configuration, S of C. S of C is the configuration obtained after the processes have went through schedule S. Okay. S is a schedule. A schedule is P1, 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 P2, P1, 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 P2, 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 P2. It's an interleaving of processes. We're going to prove this together. Very, very simple. Okay? Okay. We're going to prove this by contradiction. Okay. This is the correct phrasing. We want to prove this by contradiction. Please read this carefully and come up with the contradiction of this, or one contradiction of this that I could start with. What could I assume here to get a proof by contradiction? 2 minutes. Raise your hand. Yeah? Any step is too strong. That is a contradiction, but it's much... Right. Okay. I see what you're saying, but try to stick with this. This says, given any bivalent configuration C, there is an arbitrarily long schedule S, arbitrarily long, such that S of C is bivalent. What could be a contradiction just to this statement? If I want to proceed by contradiction, what should I assume? Yes? Exactly. So I'm going to assume that there is a maximum length, you call K, that from any bivalent configuration, there is a maximal K, a big K, such that, it doesn't need to be big, even small, there is a K such that after K steps, I reach univalent configuration. Okay, this is a contradiction. Are we together? Yes? Because what I want to apply the lemma to the initial configuration, right? And start from there. So assume I say there is a maximal length such that, so let S be the schedule with the maximal length, the bigger, such that starting from C, I reach D equals S of C, a new configuration that is univalent. Okay? I'm assuming this by contradiction. So I say, no matter what the adversary will do, there is a maximum he can do, he can keep confusing me, meaning bivalent, 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 for a maximum length. He can do that for 10 steps, or 20 steps, or 30 steps, whatever he wants, but there is a maximum, okay? So now, I'm going to do, let's assume that this D exists by contradiction. Okay, this D is the last bivalent. He can keep confusing me until D. D is bivalent. Right after D, it's going to be univalent, either 0 or 1. Are we together? Okay, good. Now, what happens, what comes after D? Either P0 executes a step or P1 executes a step. P0 of D and P1 of D are the length plus 1, which means that this is univalent, this is univalent. Okay? They cannot both be 0 valent. Why? Say higher. Because D is bivalent. The very definition of D being bivalent means they are both cases are still possible. Which means that one of them is 0 valent, the other one is 1 valent. Okay? Let's assume without loss of generality that P0 of D is 0 valent and P1 of D is 1 valent. Are we together? So until D, all decisions are possible. Next step, over. Okay? Because in D, all decisions are possible, meaning one of possibility P0 of D is 0 valent, and one is 1 valent. Okay? Now we started narrowing down the possibilities of the adversary, what it can do, what it cannot do. Okay. One of them is 0 valent, P0 of D, and the other one is 1 valent, P1 of D. Are we together? Good. Almost there. Now, so far, we didn't use registers at all. All what I have said is general. No matter what object I'm using underneath, this is all true, always. I didn't say anything about the object they are using, okay? Now I'm going to do it, and this is crucial. Now, when I say P0 executes a step or P1 executes a step, what step can they do? They access registers, right? That's the only thing they can do in the game I'm playing here. Okay. Now, I argue that the register that P0 and P1 access must be the same. Why? Because if the registers are not the same, okay, then I would be able to argue that P1 of P0 of D is the same as P0 and P1 of D. Remember that P1, P0 of D is a configuration, a set of states. If P0 and P1 access different registers, then the values of the registers after P0 goes first and then P1 will be the same as if P1 goes first and then P0. You see what I'm saying? Are we together? D bivalent. P0 goes first, he takes the register in one direction. P1 goes first, takes the register in a different direction. I argue, P0 and P1 must access the same. If they access different, then they cannot take them to different directions. Okay? So now I'm starting to zooming into what P0 and P1 could do. My first argument is they have to access the same register. Good. So P0 access the first register, P1 the same register as P0. Now, one step further. What can they do to this register? What can P0 and P1 do to this same register that I call R? And now I go case by case. I know they can only read and write, so I say, to go from D to P0 of D, obviously P0 cannot be reading. Because if it is reading, this means that the state of D is the state of P0 of D. Which means that P1 of P0 of D is the same as P1 of D. If P0 doesn't modify the registers, the state P1 of D is the same as P1 of P0 of D. So P0 cannot be reading. Okay? So it has to be writing.
So, first element of the argument, P1 and P0 access in the same register. Same element of the second element of the argument, they have to be writing. If they only read, they cannot change the state of the system by definition, right? So they had to write. Good. Therefore, both P0 and P1 have to write in R to go from D to P0 of D or P1 of D. Right? So far, so good. We are narrowing down even more what they can do. But assume they write. If they write, then the semantics of the write is such that P0 of P1 of D is going to be the same as P0 of D. Why? Because the semantics of the write is that P0 is going to overwrite P1. That's how you write, right? You overwrite what's there. Did I lose you? Very easy. They cannot read. The only thing they can do is write. But if they write, P0 of P1 of D is going to be the same as P0 of D. Contradiction again. What am I saying is, there cannot be a maximum length of a schedule such that starting from a bivalent configuration, you go to the last bivalent configuration. It's impossible. Because if we reach the notion of last bivalent before the univalent, it's impossible. Okay? If I rephrase, what I said is, if you have only reads and writes as operations, you cannot go in one step from bivalent to univalent. It's impossible. And this is due to the semantics of the read and write. If I had, as an operation, fetch and increment, I would be able to do it in one operation. Are we together? Reads and writes are too weak. This is what this proof says. They cannot go from bivalent to univalent. Yes? Okay, so here, the thing is, the configuration here is the set of registers. If it changes for you in your local state, I don't see it. So for me, it's the same. Okay? So for you, maybe you said, oh, now I know something more. But it's your local state. But the global state didn't change. What does it mean, the global state? If I come, right, and look at the registers, for me, it's the same. And it's if for me it's the same, there could not be one possibility where the decision is zero and another one where the decision is one. You see what I'm saying? Is it clear? Yes? Sure, but see, the thing here is, I could have an infinite number of registers, but I'm assuming that the algorithm is weight-free. What does that mean? After a finite number of my steps, I should decide. This number can be big. So therefore, and directly, I'm restricting the space of registers because I need to decide after finite. See what I'm saying? Okay, good. Did you get the idea of this proof? Very simple. But this is one of the most fundamental proofs in the field. It tells you that certain things cannot be done. And if you think about it, it's not surprising. It was surprising a long time ago, but now it's obvious. It's obvious because certain operations cannot go from bivalent to univalent. That's exactly what we are talking about. Okay? Sure. No, so this proof tells me that if the adversary can always decide who goes first, who goes second, for how many times, then the algorithm cannot reach consensus. More specifically, there is a situation where the algorithm cannot solve consensus. Okay. let's go back to what we said earlier and to the practical implications before concluding. Okay, now, last intellectual effort. Assume I ask you, okay, we have seen that fetch and increment is impossible because you can implement consensus with it and consensus is impossible. If I ask you, can you implement a queue, weight free with registers? What's the answer? Why? Exactly, because queue is strong enough to allow you to solve consensus. You can just think about it and then immediately, hopefully, an algorithm like this come to you. We can go to the movies, Petr and I, by using a queue. What do? Just like I did with fetch and increment. I write in my register, now I go to the queue. Assume, to simplify my life, I assume that initially the queue contains two elements. One of them I call winner, the other one is loser. Winner is the first, loser is the second. I can initialize the queue how I want. Petr and I go to the queue, with the queue. If we get, the one who gets winner chooses his movie. The one who gets loser chooses the other movie. Therefore, a queue enables me to solve consensus, and therefore, it's impossible. Okay? There are many objects like this that cannot solve consensus. Okay? And therefore, that can solve consensus, and therefore are impossible. Is it clear now how you should think of this? Because consensus is impossible with registers. Okay, good? Okay, fine. Yes? Okay, good question. What happens if Petr finds winner and dies? Right? The way I write the algorithm, I force him. Before the queuing, I tell him, Petr, before the queuing, write the movie you want to see. So if I the queue and I find loser, I know he has already written in the register. I'm going to see the movie he wanted to see. But I still go to the movies. I am weight free. I will see the movie he wanted to see and not the movie I wanted. That's fine. You see? Because I force him to write in the register before the queuing. Okay? Okay. Now, one last thing you should probably see. We can see it here. Good. Assume, now I'm ask you a different question. Assume we have three processes, not two. They want to go to the movies. Can they use fetch and increment for that? So this is, there is RS, Petr and myself. We want to go to the movies. He wants to see any preference, give me a movie name. Something you want to see or you have seen recently. Casablanca. So he wants to see again Casablanca, Petr, Asterix, I, James Bond. Can we use fetch and increment? Yeah, okay. Good intuition, but it doesn't work. Very good intuition, but it doesn't work. Okay, what this tells us is the following. There are objects that enable you to do consensus among two processes and therefore are impossible. Fine. Now, it turns out that there are objects that enables you to do consensus among two, but not three. Oh, there are objects that enable you to do consensus among three, but not four. Among four, but not five. And there are objects that enable you to do consensus among any number of processes. Okay? Are we together? They are stronger in a way. Okay. It turns out that the ability of processes to do consensus is very important. Why? Because Michel, who is not listening to me because he's reading his emails, is going to tell you tomorrow, maybe, Thursday, He's going to explain to you that once you have solved consensus among a given number of processes, say K, once you do that, you can implement any object among K processes. It's called the universal construction. Okay, so this is crucial. If I'm able to solve consensus among K processes, I can build any object among K processes. So the ability to solve consensus is very important. And this notion has a name. Somebody mentioned it earlier. It's called, somebody used the name, what was it? This K, how do we call the K? Consensus number, good. Fetch an increment has consensus number 2. It can solve consensus among 2 processes, not 3. Q has consensus number 2. Compare and swap has consensus number N, for any number or infinity, very powerful. Okay, Michel Renal is going to tell you that once you solve consensus among K, you can build any object among K. So consensus number is very, very important. This is a notion that Maurice Herlé came up with in 91, this notion of consensus number. So it's very important. It enables to tell you which object, let's say, which object you should have in a hardware in order to do everything. So for example, an object called compare and swap has consensus number N. You can do everything. If it's in your hardware, you can do everything. Of course, the cost might be big, but still you know you can. You have to think of this notion of consensus number as a way to characterize precisely the power of an object. And you can prove that at any K, there is an object with that power. Okay, now there are a lot of problems with these consensus numbers, and there are a lot of issues, and Petr has done a lot of work in this area. It's a very, very interesting area. And if you want to remember this notion of consensus number, there is this famous table, maybe you can remember it. For any element, you have a number. What is that table? Chemistry. Maybe Russian, the guy is Russian. Table, chemistry, integers, Russian, Mendeleev. Okay, any element has a number. This is exactly the same thing. Any object has a number. Here, the number is not the number of atoms in the element, but the power to do consensus. And the power to do consensus is the power to do everything, as Michel will tell you. Okay, have a nice day, and see you maybe in Lausanne, Switzerland. That's one day.